Amen. Good morning and welcome to our services here at Crossroads Baptist Church. We'd ask you to just join in, be a part of all that we do. Grab a hymnal and join us in standing. Turn to hymn number 29, hymn page number 29, At the Cross. We're going to sing it out there on that first verse. Join us in standing as we sing it out there on the first.
Alas, and did my Savior leave, and in my sovereign die. Would he devote that sacred end for such a worm as at the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received.
Good, sing it out there with me on the second. Here we go.
Was it for crimes that I had done? He wrote upon the tree. Amazing pity, grace unknown, and love beyond degree. At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart away. It was there by faith I received my sight.
Join me there on that last verse as we sing it out.
But drops of grief can ne'er repay the debt of love I owe. Dear Lord, I give myself away. 'Tis all that
you're doing good. Sing it out.
At the cross where I first saw the light, and the burden of my heart rolled away. It was there by faith I received my sight, and now I am happy all the day.
Amen. Good morning to you. And I was following along in that song and just singing away, and I almost continued. I didn't know if we were on the last verse or not, so I'm glad I wasn't leading. That's really confusing when you're leading. Have you ever done that before? Got to the last verse and couldn't remember which verse you just sang? Good, good. I've done it multiple times. It's bad. It's really bad when it's a sermon.
Yes.
Got to start all over again to get back where you think you are, but... welcome to our church this morning. It's good to have the guys from the Mobile Rescue Mission with us this morning. And we're going to have church. I hope you came for that. And we're going to praise the Lord and sing some more songs. And but we need to pray and ask God to meet with us in a very special way today. Shall we? Let's pray together. Our Heavenly Father, I come to you this hour, Father, asking for your blessings upon our lives, upon this service. And Father, we will be certain to return all the honor and glory to your name. Father, may we do this, all of this, with you in mind as our audience, Father, that we might be pleasing to you for what is said and what is done in this place, and even what is thought in our minds throughout this hour. Help us, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You may be seated. Again, thank you for coming today. If you got a bulletin on your way in, I want to draw your attention to a few things so you'll be aware of what's coming up in the life and ministry of our church, and want to help you here with some things. So what we have coming up is choir practice tonight at 4:45. So the choir's aware of that. They'll all be here ready to go. And if you want to join them, come on out yourself and join us. That'll be wonderful. And then this Thursday, we've been talking about this, and I want to invite each one of our church members out to the Foundations Christian School Christmas program. It's going to be this Thursday at 7 o'clock, and you've heard us talk about the homeschool group that meets here on Wednesdays. Well, you can come out Thursday and take a look and see some of the things that they've been doing this semester. So that's Thursday night at 7 o'clock. And then on, we've got some things coming up on Saturday, December the 9th. The teens have a Christmas party, and that's from 6 p.m. to 8 p.m. And then on December the 10th, on Sunday evening, the church choir will present their annual Christmas cantata. And if you will plan on bringing a party food to share. We'll have a nice little Christmas party after the cantata, and everyone's invited for that, so make sure you're here. But we'll start everything off at 6 p.m. On that. And then on December the 24th, we have our Christmas Eve service, and I want to draw your attention to a few different events on that day. We're going to start with an early morning service at 8:45, and we will serve coffee and donuts during that hour as well. And so that'll be our first service of the day at 8:45. So a little bit different schedule than what we're normally accustomed to, but early morning service at 8:45. And then Sunday school, regular time at 9:30. And then our late morning service at 10:30. And that early morning service at 8:45 is going to take the place of our evening service. And so we won't have an evening service on Christmas Eve. So make sure you're here. Each service will be different. So make sure you're here for all three of them. We'll have a wonderful time with the Christmas story on that Christmas Eve service. So 8:45, 9:30, 10:30, make sure you're here ready to go. That is all the announcements that I have for you. Brother Stephen is going to come and lead us in our next hymn.
Join us in standing again, hymn number 30. Hymn number 30, Nothing But the Blood. Let's sing it out there on that first verse with me.
What can wash away my sin? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. What can make me whole again? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my part and this I see, nothing but the blood of Jesus. For my cleansing this I plead, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood.
On the third, you're doing good, sing it out.
Nothing can for sin atone, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Not of good that I have done, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of.
On the last, sing it out.
This is all my hope and peace, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Think about it.
This is all my righteousness, nothing but the blood of Jesus. Oh, precious is the flow that makes me white as snow. No other fount I know, nothing but the blood of Jesus.
Turn over to hymn number 31. Hymn number 31, you're doing good this morning. We're going to continue to sing out about all that He has done for us. We'll sing it out there on the first verse of He Lives. And let this hymn get us ready for our time of offering. Let's sing it out on the first.
I serve a risen Savior, He's in the world today. I know that He is living, whatever men may say. I hear His voice of cheer, and just the time I need Him, He's always near. He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, salvation new impart. You ask me how I know He lives. He lives within my heart. On the last, reach Rejoice, rejoice, O Christian, lift up your voice. Eternal alleluia to Jesus Christ the King, the hope of all who seek Him, the help of all who find. None other is so loving, so good.
Watch me here on this chorus.
He lives, He lives, Christ Jesus lives today. He walks with me and talks with me along life's narrow way. He lives, He lives, salvation to impart. You ask me how, I know He lives. He lives within my heart.
Amen. Good singing this morning.
Good morning.
Morning.
Well, the choir's glad they're here. Good morning.
Good morning.
Isn't it good to be in God's house today?
Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning is found in Psalms 100. Make a joyful noise unto the Lord, all ye lands. Serve the Lord with gladness. Come before His presence with singing. Know ye that the Lord, He is God. It is He that hath made us, and not we ourselves. We are His people, and the sheep of His pasture. Enter into His gates with thanksgiving, and into His courts with praise. Be thankful unto Him, and bless His name. For the Lord is good, His mercy is everlasting, and His truth endureth to all generations. Brother Philip, would you come pray for the offer?
Our gracious Father, Lord, we praise Your name, Lord. We love You. We thank You for everything that You've done for us and everything You've given us. Father, we thank You for friends and family that have blessed us with their presence today, Lord. And we just pray that You'll bless this service. Pray that You'll bless this offering, Lord, that we might use it to Your kingdom and Your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Thank you.
Now it's your turn. Will you join us in standing as we sing a chorus? Isn't he wonderful, wonderful? Join us in standing. We're going to sing that chorus out one time, and then after that, the choir will make their way down, and we'll have a time of greeting here this morning. Sing it out on that chorus. Isn't he wonderful, wonderful, wonderful? Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? Eyes have seen, ears have heard, tis recorded in God's word. Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? As the instrumentalist plays, get around and greet someone here this morning. As you make your way back to your seats, we'll sing it out on that chorus. Sing it out with me here this morning. Isn't he wonderful, wonderful, wonderful? Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? Eyes have seen, ears have heard, tis recorded in God's word. Isn't Jesus my Lord wonderful? Amen. Good singing. You may be seated here this morning, and at this time, we will enjoy a special.
Still a mystery each day. Amen. Thank you, Michelle. Appreciate that. His grace still amazes me. I hope it does you. I hope that Jesus never gets old to you. May He stay fresh. The Bible in the book of John said, John bare witness of Him and cried, saying, "This was He of whom I spake. He that cometh after me is preferred before me, for he was before me. And of his fullness have we all received, and grace for grace. For the law was given by Moses, but grace and truth came by Jesus Christ." Amen. You say, what did Jesus come for? He came to bring grace and truth to your life. And the truth is, if you trust Him as your Savior, eternal life can be yours. Amen? Amen. Wonderful. I want you to turn in your Bibles this morning to the book of Luke. Luke chapter number 1. We have just finished up our Thanksgiving season. I hope you had a good Thanksgiving last Thursday. In praising the Lord and giving thanks to Him, I do want to remind you that Thanksgiving is more than just a day. It ought to be every day of our lives as Christians. And where we are giving thanks constantly to God, our Creator. And so don't lose that as we move forward away from those messages. May it still ring true in your heart, in your life, that you are ever so thankful. Now this morning as we come to Luke chapter 1, my goal over the next several weeks is to bring messages surrounding the coming and the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now this is a passage of Scripture and an area of Scripture that we are probably all most familiar with. Maybe even overly familiar with, and sometimes we get that way. I mean, I'm sure we could call on just about anybody in the room this morning and you could tell someone else about the birth of Christ and how it happened, and you would get 95% of it right from memory. So my struggle each and every year around this time of year is whether or not to come back here. We've heard it before. So my goal, though, over the next few weeks is to stay here because I think it's something that we must be reminded of. I think it's something that we must glean from in the coming of our Lord and His birth. Now with that, my goal is to, as I said, be here for the next several weeks. But I want to bring a different approach to this particular passage of Scripture, from Matthew to Luke, even into the book of John, and that's this. I want to bring the practical truths of the birth of Christ to our lives. What is it from this passage, and what is it from these stories that we can apply to our life today? And the first one I want to bring to you is in Luke chapter 1. In verse number, let's go to verse number 39. The angel has told Mary that she's going to have a baby, that he should be called Jesus, Emmanuel, God's Son. And he also told her that her cousin Elizabeth was going to have a baby as well, and that he was going to be the forerunner of the Lord Jesus. And in verse number 39, the Bible says, "And Mary arose in those days and went into the hill country with haste, into a city of Judah, and entered into the house of Zacharias, and saluted Elizabeth. And it came to pass that when Elizabeth heard the salutation of Mary, the babe leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Ghost. And she spake out with a loud voice and said, Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb. And whence is this to me, that the mother of my Lord should come to me? For lo, as soon as the voice of thy salutation sounded in mine ears, the babe leaped in my womb for joy. And blessed is she that believed, for there shall be a performance of those things which were told her from the Lord. And Mary said, my soul doth magnify the Lord, and my spirit hath rejoiced in God my Savior, for he hath regarded the low estate of his handmaiden. For behold, from henceforth all generations shall call me blessed. For he that is mighty hath done to me great things, and holy is his name. And his mercy is on them that fear him from generation to generation. He hath showed me strength with his arm, and he hath scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He hath put down the mighty from their seats and exalted them of low degree. He hath filled the hungry with good things, and the rich he hath sent away, or empty away. He hath holpen his servant Israel in remembrance of his mercy, as he spake to our fathers, to Abraham, and to his seed forevermore, or forever. And Mary abode with her about 3 months and returned to her own house. I want to draw your attention here as we see this conversation between Elizabeth and Mary. I want to draw your attention to the 46th verse, where Mary says to Elizabeth, my soul doth magnify the Lord. My soul doth magnify the Lord. And this morning I hope to preach a message entitled, The Results of Magnifying the Lord. If we are to apply these passages to our lives, I believe this is the most important place to start in how we magnify the Lord. And can we see the results of what happens through this? Let's pray together and we'll get started. Our Father in heaven, I thank Thee, for You have given us a holy scripture that we can go to. You have given us a word that we can open up and read with our own eyes and hear with our own ears and understand with our own understanding these words that You have preserved for us. Father, they leave no doubt about what happened. They leave no doubt about what is taking place and what has taken place. And so, Father, this morning as we approach this scripture and seek to apply it to our lives, Father, may we truly magnify You. May we have a view of You as a God who is holy, holy, holy. May we not come to You in vain. But Father, may we feel Your Holy Spirit and His presence in our lives. May we sense what You would have for us. And Father, if there's anyone here this morning that does not know You as their personal Lord and Savior, Father, I pray that You would open their hearts and their eyes to the truth of Your Word and why Jesus came. For we know He came to die and to rise again on the third day according to Your Word. And Father, we know that those that believe should have everlasting life, should have eternal life, because it's Your gift. Help us this morning to see the results of magnifying You in our life. It is in the name of Your Son, Jesus Christ, that we pray and that we ask all of these things. Amen and amen. To magnify. Mary said, my soul doth magnify the Lord. What does this word mean in magnify? Well, it means, first of all, to make great. To make great. Or what we would look at, if we were looking through a magnifying glass, we would say to make it bigger. To see more clearly. To make great, or to extol. Which means to speak great words to praise. It also means to exalt or to elevate or to raise in estimation. All of these explanations of the word magnify can apply to our life. Now, in this particular passage this morning, we see God's amazing grace taking place here. We see this, and we see His grand gestures at work, and we see His goodness at hand. But I don't want you to just see those things about God this morning. I want you to think about your personal view of God. How do you view God? You see, sometimes we have different viewpoints. Sometimes we seek and we look and we say, well, how I see God is as like an old grandfather who is sitting up there, and he's kind and he's gentle and he's loving. And God is certainly all of those things. But someone else may come and say, well, the way I see God is as a mean, vengeful, hateful God, who all He does is judge. You know, that's not really the proper view, is it? We don't have a hateful God. We do have a loving God. We have a just God. And in His justness, He can't tolerate sin. And that's why He sent Jesus Christ. To die on the cross for our sins, to pay sin's debt for you and for me. And so in this, we have to have this viewpoint. Some would say, I view God as my very best friend. And we hang out together. And we walk together. And we eat meals together. And I would say, yes, that's a wonderful view of God. The Bible describes Him as a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. And we can speak to God anytime we want to. It's an open access through the Lord Jesus Christ. So how do we, though, magnify God? How is it that you and I view the Lord? Now, no matter how you view the Lord, I want you to understand something. It is not about how you and I think we should view the Lord. Notice I said all of us, if we went through the room this morning, we'd probably come up with probably 50 or 60 different ways of how we're supposed to view the Lord, but our opinions really don't matter. What matters is how God says He ought to be viewed. You say, well, I don't really like that too much. Well, your view of God is probably off then. You see, in this, Mary said, "My soul doth magnify the Lord." So if we are going to make God great, and if we're going to extol and speak great words and praise Him and exalt Him and elevate Him and raise Him in estimation, we're going to have to do it according to the Word of God. And here, Mary is giving us a few things in this. And so number one, I want you to notice, the results of magnifying the Lord means this. It means your view of God, and that we view God for who He is. What is the result of magnifying God? When we magnify God, we will view God for who He is. And may I say, first off, very simply, He is God. Amen. He is God. Now, again, that may mean a few different things in your mind and in your heart, but I tell you, when we say He is God, we are meaning that He is the Creator of all things. As people, we often will say, hey, you know, we've done a lot as people. I mean, we've invented all kinds of things, haven't we? We talk about all kinds of inventions. We go through and we have, you know, scientists that geoengineer seeds and make things better and all that kind of stuff. But do you remember when God created the world? He did it from nothing. From nothing. He didn't take one material and two materials and boom, no. He spoke it into existence. Why? Because He is God. And when we magnify God and when we make Him great and when we extol Him and when we do this, we will see God and view God for who He is. Now, Mary here, she says in verse number 47, she said, "And my spirit hath rejoiced in God my Savior." Who is God to you? Is He your Savior? Do you view God as your Savior? Because that's what He is. And when we magnify God and when we make Him great and when we extol Him and when we raise Him up in our own estimation, we have to come to the place of knowing that we need a Savior and that it is God who saves us and not we ourselves. Oh, that's right. It's not about us. Who is God? He is the Savior, Mary said. And she said, "My spirit rejoiceth." First she says, "My soul doth magnify the Lord, and my spirit hath rejoiced in God my Savior." Who is God? Well, when we magnify Him, we'll realize He's our Savior. Letter B, we see not only when we view God for who He is, Mary says in verse number 49, she says, "For He that is mighty hath done to me great things, and holy is His name." May I submit to you that not only is He the Savior, but when we view God for who He is, we'll understand that He is the mighty God. He is the mighty God. He is the God not just that created the world, but He is the God that when Israel was walking out of Egypt and came to the Red Sea, it is God that told Moses to hold his staff up and the waters of the Red Sea parted on one side and parted on another side, and the Israelites crossed through on dry ground. That's the mighty God. It is the mighty God that made the sun stand still when Joshua was in battle and said, "Lord, would you?" Done. Oh, the sun stayed out. That's the mighty God. It's the mighty God that when Jonah was in the boat and the storm was raging, it was God that prepared a great fish. Jesus said it was a whale. But He prepared this great fish to come up at the same time that those sailors tossed Jonah overboard. Oh, it's that same mighty God that when Jonah hit the water, the storm ceased. And that whale swallowed him up, and for 3 days and three nights he spent in the belly of that whale. Oh, yeah, that's the mighty God. Oh, the mighty God that Mary, when she is looking at this and she's saying, "My soul doth magnify the Lord, and for He that is mighty hath done great things to me." It's the same mighty God that again another time it was storming and Jesus and His disciples were in the boat and Jesus asleep in the center of the boat. They came awaking Him and saying, "Master, carest not that we perish? Don't you care that we're going to die?" And Jesus said, "How is it that ye have no faith?" And He walks up, looks at the storm and says, "Peace, be still." Amen. Hey, it's the same mighty God. And the disciples took a step back and they looked at one another and some said, "How is it? Who is this man? That even the sea and the winds obey His voice. Who is this man?" Well, I tell you, He's the mighty God. When we have the proper view and when we magnify God, we will see Him for the mighty God that He is. Oh, He's the same mighty God that when Paul was walking as Saul on the road to Damascus with death warrants in his hand, that He shined out a bright light and knocked Paul to his knees and to his face and those around him the same way. And Paul crying out, "Oh yeah, Lord, save me." He said, "Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? It's hard for thee to kick against the pricks." And He saved him. It's that mighty God. You see, it's the mighty God when we see and when we view God for who He is. In verse number 50, the Bible says, "And His mercy is on them that fear Him from generation to generation." When we magnify the Lord, we view God for who He is. We see Him as the Savior. We see Him as the mighty God. We see Him as the merciful one. The merciful one. Notice, "And His mercy is on them that fear Him from generation to generation." I don't know about you, but I'm very grateful for the mercy of God.
Amen.
The mercy of God. Remember, we have a just God. And in His justness, when He looks at sin, it bothers Him. But in His mercy, we find a God who is very, very, very long-suffering. You see, sometimes as a pastor, I have the, I don't know that I'd call it the opportunity, maybe the unfortunate opportunity to see how sin affects people's lives. And it's heartbreaking for me. But there are times when I see personally someone that is deep-rooted into sin, upon their own choices and things, I sit here and I think, God, why don't You just consume them? God, why do You put up with this for as long as You do? Why don't You just come in, judge them, and be done? But the Bible says His ways are not our ways. And our ways are not His ways. I tell you, I am glad that God is not like me. And I am glad God is not like you. I'm glad God is God. And He is merciful. He is merciful. You see, we don't really understand mercy until mercy has been departed to us. Or imparted. That's when we truly understand mercy. That is this. That is, hey, you deserve this. But I'm not going to do it. As a child, my parents showed me mercy several times. I wish my parents would have been as long-suffering as God is. I wish I, as a father, would be as long-suffering and merciful as God is. But we're not. What He tells us to be. You see, when we magnify the Lord, when we make Him great, and when we extol Him, and when we elevate Him in our own estimation, we will view God in a certain way, and we view God for who He is. We view Him as our Savior. We view Him as our mighty God. We view Him as the merciful One. But I want you to go back to verse number 49. Because the Bible says, "For He that is mighty hath done to me great things, and holy is His name." I want you to notice that not only is He the Savior, the mighty God, the merciful One, but His name is holy. Holy is His name. Do you know God cannot separate Himself from His holiness? Oh no. No, no, no. God's holiness is who He is. Oh, yeah. Holy is His name. When Isaiah described God, he said it was as if a train had filled the holy temple. And the seraphims were flying around saying, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord. Holy is the Lord. He is three times holy." Some have said that was for God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. I don't know, but He said, "Holy, holy, holy, and holy is His name." The Bible tells us in several places, "Be ye holy, for I am holy." You see, the only way we're going to see the holiness of God is if we magnify God for who He is. If we would just view God for who He is. And we see His amazing grace in play. It's number two. What's the result of magnifying the Lord? Well, number one, you view God for who He is. Number two, you view God for what He has done. For what He has done. You say, huh? Well, look at verse 51. As Mary has given us who God is, now she's about to tell us what He's done. In verse number 51, the Bible says, He hath showed strength with His arm. He hath scattered the proud in the imagination of their hearts. He hath put down the mighty from their seats and exalted them of low degree. He hath filled the hungry with good things, and the rich He hath sent empty away. He hath hope in His servant Israel in remembrance of His mercy, as He spake to our fathers, to Abraham, and to His seed forever. And in verse number 48, if you'll go back up there just for a moment. In verse number 48, He hath regarded the low estate of His handmaiden. He hath regarded. The first thing God did for Mary is He regarded her. He took note of her. He chose her. He called her out among all of the women of the world and said, You, He hath regarded. Let me ask you something. Has God not regarded you? When the Holy Spirit of God came knocking on your heart's door, was that not in regards to you? Was that not God calling you? Oh, He hath regarded. He's regarded me. And the fact of the matter is, it is out of His holiness and out of His mercy and out of His might that He is our Savior, that He has knocked on our doors, that He has knocked on our hearts, and that Holy Spirit convicted us for who we are. That's what He has done. Oh, and you see, when we magnify God, when we magnify Him, the result is that we will notice the things that He has done for us. Oh, He hath regarded. He hath called us. Oh, yes, He has. Notice in verse 49, "For He that is mighty hath done to me great things, and holy is His name." Has God done great things for you? Oh, is that not what our whole Thanksgiving was supposed to be about, is thanking Him for what He has done for us? But you see, too often we get into this habit of getting into this thing of where we get into and we say, well, I know what He's done for me, but I'm still thinking about what He hasn't. Thinking about what He hasn't done for me. Really? That seems mighty selfish to me. When He's done so many great things, why don't we just concentrate on those? You say, because I want this. Well, what if God doesn't want that for you? You're just going to sit around and sulk and get mad at God? If you do, it's probably because you don't have the right view of God. You haven't magnified Him in your life. Because when we magnify the Lord, we'll focus in on the great things that He has done in our life. He has shown His strength in verse 51. He hath showed strength with His arm. He scattereth the proud in the imagination of their hearts. Has God shown His strength to you? It's funny, as men... men like to, you know, we have muscles, right? And sometimes we do things like this. You see those, David? Yeah. What do you think, Joe? Okay. We do this. We wear sleeveless shirts. And we flex. When I was in high school, we had a kid in our youth group named Joe Hunt. Joe was a big guy. He was probably 6'2", 6'3", in high school, played basketball, and ran his mouth like nobody's business. It must be the name Joe. I knew that just hit me. But he did. He just talked all kinds of stuff. And we were at camp one summer, and guys were in the cabin, and we're getting ready for bed, and we're arm wrestling. And Joe was beating everybody. I mean, anybody he went up against, he just beat them. And this particular year, our pastor had come to camp with us, and he was staying in the cabin, and he was laying on the bed reading a book, and so Joe started, you know, he had beat everybody, started running his mouth to pastor. Yeah. And he's like, "Come on, pastor, arm wrestle me." And pastor's, "No, I'm good." He said, "Oh, come on, no, you're afraid I'm going to beat you." And this went on. He had arm wrestled somebody else. And finally, pastor had enough. And so he just slowly rolled out of bed. And he had sweatpants on and a t-shirt. And he said, "Okay, Joe, let's go." And so he took his sleeve on his t-shirt and he pulled it up over his shoulder. And got down there, and Joe went, "All right, pastor, I got you. I got you." So somebody put their hands on him, you know, 1, 2, 3, go. And it didn't, I mean, it was like a flash. Pastor went, got up off the floor, got in bed, picked his book up, and started reading. He showed the strength of his arm. Do you know how strong God is? Again, we think about, man, who's the strongest man in the world? I don't know. I really don't care. I know it's not me, and I know it's not you, so we're good. But I definitely know how strong God is. Just his arm showed the strength of his arm. How? Well, he scattered the proud. Can you picture this in your mind? That strong arm of God coming down and just scattering the proud. That's how we get. God says, "Hey, you think you're strong? What? He hath shown his strength." God showed his strength when he sent Jesus to earth. God showed his strength when he let his son die. But God certainly showed his strength when he let him rise from the dead, giving victory over it all. So not only has he shown his strength, but he has also scattered the proud. Notice in verse number 52, "He hath put down the mighty from their seats and exalted them of low degree." You see, we do just the opposite today, don't we? I mean, we like to lift up people, but we like to lift up the right people. We like to lift up the people that have already lifted themselves. But yet God, his way, he lifted them that were of low estate, of low degree. He exalted them. The mighty. Have you ever noticed in Scripture all of the people that God used that no one in this room would have ever used? Was that not David? When Samuel came to anoint David king of Israel after Saul, because Saul had messed up, all Samuel knew was that he was supposed to go to Jesse's house and anoint one of his sons king, to be the next king. And so one by one, from the oldest and the strongest all the way down to David, and they didn't even consider David. Because at the end, Jesse's standing around saying, "I don't know." And Samuel says, "You got any more sons?" "Yeah, I got the one that, I mean, he's with the sheep." He's with the sheep, but it's just David. He says, call for him. And when he did, oh, the Spirit of God came down. Yeah, and said, that's him. Anoint him. And Samuel did. And then David went back to his sheep. But God used David, oh my. A man after his own heart, the Bible says, but none of us would have ever chosen David. You ever think about what David would have done in his life if he had not been chosen by God? I guarantee you, we wouldn't be talking about him today. But God elevated him, exalted him. He was low degree. What about Gideon? Remember old Gideon? God chose him. Said, you're going to lead my people. You're going to win this victory. And Gideon said, nobody's going to listen to me. I'm nobody. And God said, yeah, they will. Because I called you. I'm nobody. And he was nobody. I mean, he was just hiding wine with his family on the threshing floor when God spoke to him. And God exalted him in such a way, had 30,000 men in his army. Ha ha, we can do this. And God said, no, it's too many. It's just too many, Gideon. Got down to around 10,000. God said, that's too many. Got down to 300. And God said, now we can go. 300? Yeah. And God wrought a great victory that day. Amen. With a man that no one else would have chose to lead 300, let alone to a victory. Yeah, he exalts the low, not the mighty. Not the mighty. He exalts the low. You know, I know that we will, sometimes we think of Samson, don't we? I don't know how you picture Samson. But most people picture Samson with this long, flowing, awesome hair, muscles ripped out of everything. Because that's the only way he could have done all the things that he did, right? It wouldn't surprise me a bit if Samson weighed 120 pounds, about 5 foot tall, with just a lot of long hair. And I'm saying that because if Samson had been this mighty, muscular, you know, bodybuilder, muscles ripped out of everywhere, everyone would have thought, oh, well, that's how he did it. But they couldn't figure out, how's this guy doing all of these things? Except God called him. None of you would have called Samson. How about Moses? You know, Moses? He couldn't speak. He couldn't. He stuttered all over the place. And he told God about it too. God, you can't use me. And God showed him that he could. He hath put down the mighty and exalted the low. He hath filled the hungry with good things, in verse 53. And the rich he hath sent empty away. Do you need God? You see, when you magnify the Lord, when you magnify Him, you will see Him for who He is, and you will view Him for what He has done. Are you hungry? Do you need Him? Because I don't need God. Well, you do, you just don't know it, because you haven't magnified Him enough. He hath hope in His servant Israel in remembrance of His mercy. Just simply means He helped. He's helped. He's helped His servant in remembrance of His mercy. There that is again. Reminding us of who God is. He is so merciful. He could have consumed Israel when they were walking through the wilderness, griping, complaining, not viewing God for what He has done or for who He is, just for what He hasn't done. Yeah. What are the results of magnifying the Lord? Well, number one, you can view God for who He is. Number two, you'll view God for what He has done for you. And number three, when you magnify the Lord, you will never get over who He is and what He's done. Can I say that again? When you have magnified the Lord and you view Him for who He is and you view Him for what He has done, you will never get over who He is and you will never get over what He has done in your life. Go back to verse number 46 and 47. The Bible says, "And Mary said, My soul doth magnify the Lord, and my spirit hath rejoiced in God my Savior." My spirit hath rejoiced. You know what Mary was doing? Right? My soul doth magnify the Lord, but my spirit hath rejoiced. She found joy in it, and then she found joy in it again. That's rejoicing. Over again. Yeah. She found rejoicement and joying in God her Savior again. You see, you'll never get over it. You say, "Well, I've heard these stories so many times. I don't need to hear them again." No. We need to hear them again. Over and over and over again, that they may never get old. That is the result of magnifying the Lord. There's a husband and wife. They'd been married 50-some years, and driving down the road in the man's truck. He's just driving along, and his wife, she looks over at him, and she says, "Honey, I really miss when we used to drive down the road like this and snuggle." Yeah, some of you are remembering that. "I miss that." And you know what he said? He looked at her and he said, "Well, I haven't moved." Right. Amen. You say, "I've been saved all these years and I just don't get excited about it anymore. I'd like to." May I tell you, God hasn't moved?
That's right. Amen.
May I submit to you that God hasn't moved? So if anyone's moved, it's us. Because He hasn't. I'll close with this. You know, for people, we like to get close to people. And when we get close to people, we begin to see things that we didn't see before. You find things out about people that you didn't know before. Some of them are flaws. Rachel found out after we got married, I have flaws. She didn't know it before. I was her loving man with strong arms. We got married and the flaws came. And you know what I found out? She has flaws too. Yeah. And you know what? She loves me in spite of my flaws, and I love her in spite of her flaws. Yeah. Oh. We have flaws, but the closer we get, the more flaws we see. You say, some people say, I don't want to be close to anybody because every time I get close to somebody, I get hurt. You don't have to. You don't have to. It's all about how you view it. Now, the fact of the matter is this. With God, it's just the opposite. When we magnify the Lord, and we see God for who He is, and we view God for what He has done, we don't find flaws. We find His perfection. And usually when we're finding flaws in God, it's because we're so far away from God that we can't see who He really is. So what we need to do is magnify Him. And the only way to magnify God is not with a magnifying glass, is to get right up next to Him and discover who He is and what He has done. And you will see that God is more beautiful and more loving and more caring and more kind than you ever thought He was over there. Why? Because you've magnified Him. You've gotten closer. With people, we'll always see more flaws. With God, we just see more perfection. Amen. Every head bowed, every eye closed. How do you view God? We need to have a high and great and lifted up, magnified view of God. Get in the proper view and see how truly magnificent God is. As heads are bowed and eyes are closed this morning, it's possible that there's someone here that doesn't know the Lord as their Savior, and you need to trust Him. First off, I want to invite you to come. In just a moment, we'll stand, we'll have an invitation. If you need to trust Christ as your Savior, you come and allow somebody to take a Bible and show you how you can know for sure that when you die, heaven would be your home. Number two, you may be here and you say, I've been away from God, and I want to come and see God for who He is. I want to magnify Him. I want to exalt Him. I want to lift Him up and make Him great in my life. Why don't you just come and magnify the Lord? See Him for who He is. See Him for what He has done. And never get over it. Our Father, have Your way during this time. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. As you stand to your feet this morning, as Brother Stephen sings, heads are bowed, eyes are closed. So you need to be more magnified in your life. I can't magnify Him for you. You've got to see it. You've got to see Him for who He is. I can tell you as long as the day is, but until you see it for yourself, it'll mean nothing. Turn your eyes upon Jesus.
Look full in His wonderful face.
My soul doth magnify the Lord.
And the kings of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory and grace.
Amen. And all God's people said, amen. Thank you for being here today. We'll do it all over again tonight at 6 o'clock. And so I invite you out for it and trust you will, hope you will. If you have not noticed, we have the Christmas card box in the back there. So for those of you that are new or not sure, basically if you want to hand out Christmas cards, you can hand them out individually if you would like to, or you can place them in the box there. They're labeled as far as last name is concerned, as far as A through whatever and B through whatever, or however it is. So just put it in that slot there. And then if you'll check them each week before Christmas, you'll have all of your Christmas cards. cards. I know there's some back there this morning, so if you want to check that box, that'll be wonderful. But we're going to dismiss with a song, and Brother Stephen is going to come lead us, and then we'll be dismissed. God bless you.
Let's dismiss here this morning on that chorus. Thank you, Lord. Let's sing it out this morning. Thank you, Lord, for saving my soul. Thank you, Lord, for making me whole. Thank you, Lord, for giving to me thy great salvation, so rich and free. Amen. You are dismissed.